Okay, we're going to get down here. We're going to do the wanderings is what we're going to try to cover here, a large chunk of material. But as you know, the Israelites, they left Egypt around 1446 B.C. They left on the 15th day of the first month, and they entered the wilderness. They cross over the wilderness, entered the wilderness there after passing through the Red Sea, and then they journeyed down to Mount Sinai. And they arrived there 3 months after they had crossed the Red Sea. So it's quite a trek down there, but they wind up down there 3 months after having crossed the Red Sea. And then according to Numbers chapter 10, verse 11, they leave Mount Sinai on the 20th day of the second month of the second year of their having left Egypt. So they were camped at Sinai for 11 months and 5 days. That's quite a while to be down there. Now, during that time, as we've already looked at, I'm just trying to set where we are. During that time, they entered into a covenant with God. They received numerous laws and rules governing their lives and their worship. And the focus of the laws from Exodus 25 through Numbers chapter 10, verse 10, the focus of those laws is worship. And you see a number of things in that regard. Those sections treat, among other things, the ark and the tabernacle, the priestly clothing, the ordination of the priests, sacrificial laws, the consecration of the priesthood, the teaching on clean and unclean, the Day of Atonement, the principle of life being in the blood, laws of holiness, religious vows. So you see all of that up through Numbers chapter 10. Now, the tabernacle, you know, the tabernacle is this tent, which is the tent of meeting where God specially manifested his presence among the people of Israel. And the tabernacle was erected and consecrated on the first day of the first month of the second year of leaving Egypt. And in the middle of that month, the Israelites celebrated Passover. You see that in Numbers chapter 9, 1 to 5. And then they departed from Mount Sinai just a little over a month after that. Okay, so that's the kind of the chronology of what's happening here. The people, now there are scholars and a lot of people, they often question, you know, how could such an immense human and animal population survive in southern Sinai? How could they find enough food and water for such large human and animal populations to stay there that long? And you have people that question that. But I like this comment by Eugene Merrill. He says, the biblical account suggests, however, that the whole enterprise from beginning to end, from Egypt to Canaan, was an unending series of miraculous acts whereby God redeemed, sustained, and delivered his people. You see, God is at work in preserving them. He's feeding them. He's taking care of them. So when I have people going, how can you possibly live there? Because God is doing it. You see, this is his program and his plan, and he's bringing them out, and he's taking care of that. Now, the Israelites, their course of travel, as they leave Sinai, their course of travel was set by the cloud that covered the temple. When it lifted, they followed it to the next place where it settled down. So you have this cloud, we stay. It lifts, we follow. It comes down, we stop. And that was what they were doing. So as they depart from Mount Sinai, their course is set. They travel the course that's set by the cloud. And their first encampment, it was only a 3-day journey from Mount Sinai, a place called Taberah. And the precise location of that and many of the other places, it's not known. We have a general idea of the places, but they haven't been discovered with any kind of certainty. And at Taberah, the people there, they complained about their difficulties, their misfortunes. Oh, this is such a bummer for us. You know, look at all the hardships that we have to do and how we've been living and all that kind of thing. Well, fire from the Lord comes down and burns up outer parts of the camp. And the people cried out and Moses prayed and interceded for them. And then the fire died down. In fact, that's where that name Taberah comes from. So here they are, they're 3 days out from Sinai, they're complaining about their misfortunes and their hardships, and God says, well, here's some fire for you. I don't like this, what you're doing. Ah, they claim Moses, and then the fire dies down. Well, then the people complain about the lack of meat to eat. is right at the time. Then they're complaining about the lack of meat and about the manna that God had graciously provided them. They're living in the wilderness and he's giving them food. Miraculously giving them food and they don't like it. They're complaining about it. They had the audacity to say that things were better for them in Egypt. Here they say, Numbers chapter 11, verses 4 to 6. Now the rabble that was among them had a strong craving. And the people of Israel also wept again and said, "Oh, that we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt that cost nothing. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up and there's nothing at all but this manna to look at. I'm sick of this. But when I was in Egypt, man, I had fish and I had all those good things there, you know." And so, you know, most of you know the story for sure. God then covers the camp in quail, and then he struck down many with a plague. And this place is known as Kibroth Hatava, which means graves of craving. You see, they were craving meat and complaining and complaining. So the place becomes graves of craving because God sent a plague among them. Because there's just this insane ingratitude. But do you see yourself in any of that? Ah, you see, I see myself complaining about things that have been provided for me, even things I've prayed to receive. I see myself sometimes complaining about the very blessings that God has given me. But that's what that's called. Now the people, they next camp at a place called Hazeroth. And here it's marked on this map, but its location is uncertain. But they camp at a place called Hazeroth, where we're told in Numbers 12 that Moses' brother and sister, Aaron and Miriam, they challenged his unique role in God's relationship with Israel. They didn't think that, listen, Moses, why should you have this certain particular role? And they challenged that, and God rebuked them. He rebuked them, and then he inflicted Miriam with leprosy for 7 days, just to let them see, this is serious business. I have chosen Moses. And they're complaining about it, and he says, no, this is not right for you to do this. Miriam, you got 7 days. You have this. They say, heal. And he says, well, even if you know somebody dishonors his father, it's going to last for a while. So she can keep this for 7 days. And so he has that. Now, the Israelites, they left Hazeroth, and they camped at many other sites en route. Oh, I got this cool little thing. En route to Kadesh Barnea. Okay, they camped, and you can see there in Numbers 33 and other places where you see that it's told where they camp, but the sites, we don't know where they are. Now, this one, Kadesh Barnea, is almost certainly known. That's almost certainly the right spot for Kadesh Barnea. But they camped at many places, and it's at Kadesh Barnea, that location that's known with a high probability. That's where this pivotal event involving the 12 spies happens. This is where they are when the spies are sent out. Now, at Kadesh Barnea, God instructed Moses, you see in Numbers 13:2, to send men from each of the 12 tribes to go spy out the land of Canaan. And it was to prepare Israel for conquering the land that God was already in the process of giving them. He's in the process of giving them this land. And he says, you have the people go spy it out to prepare them to go ahead and take what I'm in the process of giving them. And so they wind up, they do that. Now the 12, which included Joshua and Caleb, they scoped out the land all the way from here, all the way well north of the Sea of Galilee. So they're traveling a couple of hundred miles. But they go, and it's debated about how far north of the Sea of Galilee they went. But they go up north of the Sea of Galilee, they scope it out, and then they returned with a report 40 days later. And the spies, all of them agreed that the land that they had seen, that it was a rich and tremendously bountiful land. They could see this idea of it's a land flowing with milk and honey. This means that it is super pasture land, which would then feed the animals that would produce milk. Bountiful flowers that bees and all would use, and then we'd have one. So it's just this rich land, bountiful land, and they all agreed about that. But 10 of the spies told the people, in essence, look, that's all true, but the cities are too fortified, and the inhabitants are too large and too fierce to make conquering feasible. And just, you just can't, you know, no, it's a great land, no doubt. Land flowing with milk and honey. But man, those places are fortified, and the people are really big and mean, and we just, I just don't think it's really feasible for us to think about taking that land. Now, mind you, these are people who just waltzed out of Egypt, complete with the Egyptians' gold and jewelry that they gave them, and who had watched Pharaoh's army drown. But they said, you know, I just don't think, when I look here, I don't think. Well, the people of Israel, you see, then at that point, they're all discouraged and they're fearful. Why? Because of these 10 voices. They've made the people fearful. They've weakened the people. That's a bad thing to do. You see, that's a bad thing to do to the community of God, is to weaken the people. And so they came in and the people are all afraid. They complain against Moses for bringing them out here where they're going to be killed by the inhabitants of Canaan. You brought us out here to die by the sword. If we take this land, we now see that we're going to get killed. We're going to be slaughtered in battle. Oh, what a bummer. What a just terrible place thing that you've done. And they wanted to choose a leader to take them back to Egypt. You see that in Numbers 14:4. Joshua and Caleb, they tried to look and said, no, don't talk like that. God is able to do the job. Don't rebel against him. And they picked up stones and they're ready to kill them. They said, no, we want to go back to Egypt. We don't want to go in here and face these terrible, large, fierce people. We're going to die by the sword. How could you possibly do that to us? Let's get somebody to take us back to you. Don't do that. We'll kill you. If you oppose our move to get somebody to take us back to Egypt, we'll kill you. Well, the Lord appeared, and he rebuked the people. And after Moses interceded for them, the Lord told the people through Moses that none of those who are aged 20 and older who were listed in the census of men able to go to war. That's the census that's given in Numbers chapter 1, which is why it's called Numbers. But you have this, he says, none of the people listed in that census except Joshua and Caleb would enter the promised land. Now, for what it's worth, women aren't listed in that census. Neither were Levites listed in that census. And Levites, by the way, no representative of their tribe was among the 12 spies. Because you had Ephraim and Manasseh, the two sons of Joseph, those tribes had representatives among the spies. But anyway, it says, nobody 20 and older who's listed in that census will enter the land except Joshua and Caleb. Rather, Israel's entrance will be delayed. It will be delayed, you see, until they've lived in the wilderness 40 years. Now, it's not clear whether that means 40 years total. See, from the time that they entered over here, the wilderness of Shur, and then came down to the wilderness of Sin, and you have the wilderness of Paran, and over here is the wilderness of Zin. But whether it includes that time, then it would be an additional 38 years, or whether it means 40 additional years. But in any event, they're going to live in the wilderness so long, you see, that the people, all the people there on that census except Joshua and Caleb, they were going to die. And so he's basically saying, your life from here out is going to be life lived in the wilderness, because you would not trust me when I told you we could go in. So they're going to wind up living there. And the 10 spies, by the way, who instigated the rebellion, they didn't have to wait that long to die, because God sent a plague among them and they died from the plague. You see, you see that Numbers 14:38. That was a serious thing for them to have done. And you see that the people and their children now, the young, those who are under 20, they're going to spend 40 years in the wilderness because of that. And that's what happens to them. The people, they mourn, you know that. They mourn, and when they heard that news, and they said, oh, you know, this is just terrible. Oh, this is a bad thing. So they decided that they could circumvent God's judgment. God has said, you're not going to enter into that. You're going to stay out here. You're going to wander in the land in the wilderness for 40 years. They decided that they could circumvent God's judgment, and we're going to attack the land. We'll just come up and we'll just, no. Watch, we're just going to come up and attack the land. And Moses says, God won't be with you. Don't do that. Don't think that this is happening by you. If God's not with you, you're not going to succeed. And so they forge ahead anyway, and Moses told them it would turn out badly. And then they do that only to see the Amalekites and the Canaanites defeat them, and they have to flee. And so they run back down, and they're defeated, and then that begins really the wilderness wandering proper. And we're told really little about the events during the decades of their wilderness wandering. We're told very little about that, about the decades when Israel's in the wilderness. And that's not surprising, really. Because as someone has said, Numbers is not a history of Israel, but an essay about the consequences of disobedience. You see, that's really the point. And you get that point without having, a log of everything that happened during the decades when they're in the wilderness. Now, presumably, Kadesh Barnea, presumably this served as some kind of base of operation for the Israelites during those years when they're in the wilderness, those decades when they're in the wilderness because of their unbelief. God was bringing them into the land. They rebel and won't believe me and say, we can't do that. Take us back to Egypt. We're not going to do that. We can't do that. They're too big. They're too powerful. And God says, all right, yeah, have it your way. You're not going to do it. You're going to stay in the wilderness. But the younger people will grow up, and I will take them in. Now, we do get some indication, some reports of some events that happened during this period. And in Numbers chapter 16, you have the story of Korah. Now, Korah's a Levite, and he and 250 community leaders, they opposed Moses and Aaron on the basis that they should all have equal access to God, you see. Their line is, look, all Israel is holy. All of Israel is holy. So no one family line should be exalted to the priestly function. What's that about? We're all holy, right? I mean, there should be no distinction so that one family line is given the priesthood. So they didn't like that idea. And see, what that is, that was a challenge to God's right to choose select groups for specific purposes. No. You can't pick Aaron's line to be priests. All of Israel is holy. So you can't, that's not right. So it was a challenge to God's right to choose select groups for specific purposes. You see? And that challenge, and you see that spirit alive today, by the way, in those who challenge, for example, God's right to choose men as leaders of the family and leaders in the church. How's that be? Women, they're smarter, better, whatever it is. How can we be stuck with men leading? God chose them. And you can take it up with Him. You see, but He has a right to choose these things. And He has made that choice there. Now, we had Dathan and Abiram. They opposed Moses' authority as a leader of Israel on the basis that he hadn't brought him into the promised land. Look, the guy said, come out here, we're going to go. And look, he hasn't produced. And so they opposed him on that basis. Well, you know the result. The result of this rebellion is that Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, they were swallowed by the earth. And the 250 community leaders were incinerated by God. Now, that's just Bible, right? Now, some of these things, I sometimes get the sense that we don't like, how God is revealed to us sometimes. We say, well, no, can we soften that or do some? This is who God is. He's holy. And this affront to God from the people He's delivered from slavery and brought them out and blessed them and cared for them. And they repeatedly, I don't believe you. I don't believe you. I'm not going to go in. Why did you do this? Send me back to Egypt. Send me back to Egypt. Why did you pick Moses? Why did you pick Aaron? I can't stand it. And God said, okay, warning. And here you see what happens to these rebels. God is not to be trifled with. And you see it here and you see it many other places. It's all over the Bible. Now the people, they then gather in opposition to Moses and Aaron. They apparently sided with Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, and they were unwilling to accept God's judgment in the matter. God brought a plague on the group. And then Aaron, he made atonement on their behalf by offering incense. And then God relented, but not before 14,700 Israelites had died. You see? So God relents, but you have this punishment that is inflicted on them. In Numbers 17, God is trying to get the people, he's going to give them graciously another example. So they can look at this and say, says, all right, everybody, give me your staffs. You know, staff's this old dried stick. And he says, collect them together. And he says, you know, Aaron, you sign here on Levi. And what happens to Aaron's staff? Aaron's staff winds up sprouting, producing blossoms, and bearing ripe almonds. You see, and this was confirmation and visible proof for the people who were continuing to have difficulty accepting God's choice. And he says, look, do you see this dry staff that I have caused to now produce ripe almonds? Do you not recognize whose staff that is? And do you not see that is confirmation that I, God, have chosen them? And you must accept it. And so he does that, but he gives that to them, you see, graciously. And that's proof of God's selection of Moses as a leader and of Aaron's line as the priesthood. Numbers chapter 20, Miriam dies. And the people quarrel with Moses and Aaron because there's no water. They just, you know, this is just crazy. We don't have any water. We can't survive. And this is where Moses, he spoke to the people and he struck the rock with his staff to bring forth water rather than speak to the rock as the Lord had commanded him. And for this unbelief, and that's how it's characterized. Unbelief. God said, you speak to the rock and it'll bring forth water. He speaks to the people and strikes the rock with his staff. And God says to him, because of your unbelief, you see, that act of unbelief, that you will not enter the promised land. This leader who comes out, he will not enter the promised land. Moses himself was not permitted. He's, of course, later he's going to be able to see into it from the other side of the Jordan, but he's not allowed to enter it because of that. Now, near the end of this wilderness wandering period, Moses, he made plans to enter Canaan from the east. This is going to be how we're going to come in. He's going to enter Canaan's land, but he's going to enter from the east. So he makes plans to do that, but this would require Israel to traverse Edomite and Moabite territory. You see, if I'm going to go here and I go up the King's Highway, that's this green line, then I have to come over here and I'm going to go through Edom and I'm going to go through Moab. So he sends messengers to the king of Edom asking permission that he can cross the land. He says, listen, I'm not going to mess with you. I'm not going to take your stuff. I just want to get through your property. Let me just get through your territory. That's all I'm after. And the king of Edom, he denies that request. And then the Israelites, they set out from Kadesh Barnea and go to Mount Hor. Now this has its here, but Mount Hor, the location of it is not known with any certainty. But they go to Mount Hor, and that's where Aaron dies. But something happens, whether they went up further or it's simply the move to Mount Hor, but the Canaanite king of this city of Arad, this Canaanite king of this, it's a city-state, you know how this is. Like they're like little nations. This city-state, the Canaanite king of Arab, he learns of Israel's presence. You got this huge population of people down here. And so whether they moved up here and he gets word about it, well, he comes and attacks them. He attacks them. You've got this king, says, I've got a military, I've got forces. Here they are. I'm going to do a preemptive strike. I'm not going to wait around and let all these people come up here and overrun me and kill me. So he goes down and he attacks the people, and the Lord grants Israel the victory, and they destroyed Arad, and presumably the cities nearby, the towns and villages that had presumably allied with the king. So they wind up destroying them, and then Israel, they then turn south. You see, they then turned south and went all the way to the Red Sea, which meaning the Gulf of Aqaba. As that, you see that red line there. You see that in Numbers 21, verse 4. Now they do this, apparently they're going to outflank Edom. Edom has said you can't cross, and they're not looking to pick a fight with Edom because they're only interested in getting in the over here. So they go all the way south down to the Red Sea, to the Gulf of Aqaba here. They travel that distance. And they apparently see the game plan apparently is we're going to go down here, and then we're going to outflank Edom to the east. And instead of traveling on the King's Highway, which was a very well-known and the easiest route north and south, they're going to travel further east out into the wilderness, out into the desert. So on this route that is known as the Way of the Wilderness of Edom or the Way of the Wilderness of Moab. So they're going to come and they're going to kind of skirt around them out here. That's the plan. So they drop all the way down here south. Now that's a long way to go, by the way. I mean, I don't like walking around the block, and this is, it's a long way. And they're going to go down there. That's a long journey. Well, on that journey, the people, again, they spoke against God and Moses. And this is where the Lord sends the poisonous snakes among them. You sit here and say, when I see how God is tolerant of people and patient, they're still complaining. He brought them out of Egypt when they cried out to him. And so they're complaining. He brings these poisonous snakes among them. And when the people repented of their sin, Moses prayed and the Lord provided a cure for the snake bites. And he had Moses, he said, I want you to fashion a bronze serpent, a bronze snake, and I want you to hoist it up on a pole. And whoever's bitten, whoever then faces death, who has been bitten, if he will just look at that, he will then be healed and live. You see, so he puts that. And you, of course, remember when Jesus, in John chapter 3, verses 14 and 15, he appeals to that healing event. And he says in John 3, 14 and 15, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Just as those people who were doomed, who faced certain death, if they would look, they would receive the mercy of God. And Jesus makes an analogy and says, so too those who have faced certain death because of their sin, if they will just look to me, there is healing and life there. So Jesus uses that. And then on this long journey south, where you have the people, as I say, they complain there. And then having avoided conflict, right, this map moves things a little bit further north. That's why I switched it. Having avoided conflict, see, with Edom and Moab, as Israel continues north, they send messengers to Sihon. He's the Sihon here. Whoa, he's the king of... I need to go back? Yes, no? There we go. Here, this king of Amorites. See, so here's Edom down here, Moab, and he controls this territory in here from the Arnon River to the Jabbok River, although Og, who's another Amorite king, his territory may have pierced down into here. But you have this. This is a good area of territory. So they're still coming north. So they go ahead and they say to Sihon, they say, hey, we want to pass through your territory. You know, just as they had done they had tried with the king of Edom, said, we want to pass through your territory. Well, he says, listen, he attacks them. He attacks them. And he attacks him and Israel defeats him. This is one of these blessings of God. Can we pass through? I got something for you. Pass through, all right. He comes after him. What happened? God gives him the victory. This is a pretty potent dude. You know, he's controlling all of this territory right there. And so God gives Israel the victory right there. That gave Israel then control of the land east of the Jordan. Here's the Jordan. So now Israel now controls the land from the Arnon, about 45 miles north up to the Jabbok, and west of the Ammonite territory. So basically in this rectangle. That's now Israel. God has given that to them. They got attacked. God said, uh-uh. You're going to win. And so they then have that victory there. Now, so they take that victory, then north of the kingdom of Sihon, there was another Amorite leader, a man named Og of Bashan. And he controlled land. He controlled the land from the Jabbok River far north of the Yarmouk River. Okay? So you have Sihon controls basically this area. And then Og controls from here another Amorite leader all the way up here. This is his territory. And so they're heading north. He controls that region. And these are the regions of Gilead. You see, Gilead and Bashan. This is really rich territory. Fertile pasture land. And so he's the one who controls now. Now Israel had advanced all the way to Edrei, which is about 30 miles southeast of the Sea of Galilee, right here, before Og could come against them. And so Og then comes against them. He advances against them, but God gives Israel the victory over Og, which meant now they control from the Arnon Valley, from the Arnon River, all the way to Mount Hermon. So they control this entire region east of the Jordan River. That's about 150 miles. God gave them that land as they're being attacked and these kinds of things. See, that's what prompted Balak. You remember the story with Balaam? That's what prompted Balak, who's the king of Moab, the land to the south now. You see that this land is all now controlled by Israel. Well, this guy down here is saying, that's not good for me. You see, he says, I'm thinking they're going to come and they're going to take my territory. So that's what prompts him, Balak, the king of Moab, to hire Balaam to put a curse on Israel. Because he sees, he's afraid that now that they have this thing, they're just going to absorb my territory. That's not their intention, though, right? They're going over to the land that God has given them. But he doesn't know that, or doesn't believe what they told him. And so he's saying, and so he hires Balaam, but Balaam was unwilling or unable to speak falsely in God's name, and he winds up blessing Israel rather than cursing her. You see, I'm going to give you all these things. He says, look, I can't. And so he blesses Israel rather than cursing her. But Balaam, after that, however, he succumbed to the temptation to harm Israel. I guess, you know, all this money on the table. He says, I can't prophesy falsely in God's name, or God won't let him, one or the other. But he still liked that money that they were throwing around. And so he winds up, he succumbed to the temptation to harm Israel because he gives the Moabites advice to use their women to pull the Israelites into idolatry. That'll work. You see, you use your women, you can pull the dudes. You see, you use the women and you'll be able to pull them into idolatry, specifically the worship of Baal of Peor. And you can see what I'm talking about here in Numbers 25, 1 to 9, and in Numbers 31, 15 and 16, you can see Balaam's role in that. You also see Balaam spoken of in 2 Peter 2:15 and in Revelation 2:4. See, Baal of Peor, that's the Canaanite form of Baalism. You know, different twists and flavors. And this involves sexual immorality. So he says, listen, now you get them in here into your idolatry, which, by the way, part of that, it involves sex with the women. Okay? Now, is that, yeah, that's pretty clever. It's pretty clever. You know, the bad guy's trying to pull somebody. There's some powerful tools in this world. That's one of them. Okay? That's one of them. And he says, okay, you go ahead and do that. And so this winds up, he pulls the Israelites into idolatry. And at God's direction, Moses, then he tells the judges, those who are over different sections of the people of Israel, to kill those of their men who had yoked themselves to Baal of Peor. You see, that's how serious it is. That's how serious it is to kill those. And while everybody's mourning and weeping over the situation, you've got this Israelite man who brazenly brings right before the people who are mourning over what has happened. He brings this Midianite woman, Cosby, right into the Israelite camp and gives her to his brothers that they may do with her what they find, you know, whatever they find. Whatever you want to do, you go ahead and have your way with her. And so they wind up doing that. And this is when Phinehas, who's the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, he killed both Cosby and Zimri, who was the man who was engaging in sexual immorality with her, by driving the spear through him. He killed them both because of what they were doing. And that stopped the plague, by the way. That act of holy wrath by Phinehas, who was so incensed that someone would treat the holy God this way, that he killed them, and that stopped the plague, but not before 24,000 Israelites had died. Numbers chapter 27, Moses, pursuant to the Lord's instruction, he publicly commissioned Joshua to be his successor. And Joshua is described in verse 18 as a man in whom is the Spirit. Joshua is a powerful leader, a God-guided person. And in Deuteronomy chapter 31, there's a private commissioning. As they're on the brink of Moses' death and the people entering the land, there's this private commissioning where Moses and Joshua, they met with God in the tent of meeting. And you'll have other times where it is so clear that God wants it clear to the people of Israel, Moses, his authority is being transferred to Joshua. So that you will know that Joshua is a kind of Moses to you as he's going to be leading the people. In Numbers 32, Moses tells the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and a half tribe of Manasseh that they can have the land east of the Jordan River. You see, all of this land that they had captured from Sihon and from Og, well, you see, you have Reuben, Gad, and the half tribe of Manasseh. They say, look, you know, this looks like great turf to us. And we'd really like to have this. Is that okay? And he says, yeah, you can have that land. But the condition is you have that land, but you're not going to be able just to sit over here and then have your brothers go across and fight for all this territory. No, that's not going to work. What you're going to have to do is you get this land, but all of your warriors, all your men, you join your brothers and you go fight with them the battle. When that has been subjugated, well, then you can come back over here and live over here. All right, so that's the condition on which it's given. Let me say a little bit about the book of Deuteronomy in like 5 minutes, okay? That's all you get. Deuteronomy. All right. It's the last of the five books, as you know, collectively known as the Pentateuch. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Those five. Those five together, they're known as the Pentateuch. And Deuteronomy is the last one. And Deuteronomy picks up where the book of Numbers left off. Okay. On the plains of Moab, by the Jordan, across from Jericho. So here they are. They're over here. Plains of Moab, right in here. And they're going to cross over. But this is where the book of Deuteronomy picks up. In Deuteronomy, it contains three lengthy speeches. But it's Moses' farewell address, essentially. It's his farewell address and his charge to the people, in which here he is, the people are on the brink, on the verge of entering the land that God had promised to them centuries ago. And Moses essentially retells the teachings and the events of Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. And there are three main speeches that Moses gives here in Deuteronomy. You have this brief prologue, and then the first speech of Moses runs from chapter 1, verse 6 through chapter 4, verse 43. And that focuses on the great king's faithfulness. That's like the main theme of that part, that speech of Moses. It focuses on God's mighty acts on behalf of Israel from the covenant at Sinai. You see, from the covenant at Sinai up to the point of Moses' speech. So he's looking back at God and saying, you know, to them, the great king's faithfulness. And as Arnold and Beyer say, this survey of Israel's recent past illustrates the benefits of keeping the covenant as well as the pitfalls of disobedience. You see, he rehearsed that for them. He rehearsed that for them. You know, even Moses wouldn't be allowed to enter the promised land because of his disobedience. This is important. Obeying God is serious. In chapter 4, Moses exhorts them to obey in the present and in the future. And then he warns them repeatedly, for example, in chapter 4, verse 9, chapter 4, verse 23, not to forget the covenant. It's easy to do, and you see the people of Israel all the time. When God is right there doing something, manifesting himself, oh, we're so sorry, we're so sorry. As soon as life goes on in a more normal rhythm, where is he? Where is he? Don't forget. Don't forget that you as a people, you came to God and agreed, and you were in a covenant with him and said, yes, we will obey all these things. We will be faithful to you. Don't forget that. Don't forget that. That's first bell, right? All right. All right. So he tells them that. Now, after an introduction, the second speech runs from chapter 5, verse 1, through 26, 19. And Moses there, he restates the covenant laws, you see, in ways that are focused on life in the promised land. He kind of rearticulates them. He expands them, extends them, and puts them in a way he draws out and fills in those laws and teachings in ways that are intended to bless the people in their future lives as they live in Canaan's land. You see, he gives them that, and he warns them and he exhorts them to faithfulness, and he gives them additional instructions. And it is in this section that there are a number of things you could, obviously all the Bible is great, but I pulled out a couple of things I just wanted to read and maybe say a word about. This is where you get the famous Shema, where he says in Deuteronomy 6, 4-9, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might." We sometimes forget that. And we have the idea that service and worship in the Old Testament was supposed to be some dry, heartless. Never! God has never called for that. He has always insisted that people serve him from their hearts. But he says here, And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Pretty important stuff. Yes? Important. You see, always, always. Why? Because you're going to transmit to future generations who God is and how important it is and what he desires of people. You see? You're going to transmit that to them. And it's here in this section, that in Deuteronomy chapter 8, 11 to 18, where Moses so powerfully warns them about the temptation to forget God in the midst of plenty. I know this is small text, but I wanted to squeeze it all in on one slide. He says, "Take care lest you forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments and his rules and his statutes, which I command you today. Lest when you've eaten and are full and have built good houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks multiply and your silver and gold is multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, then your heart be lifted up and you forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrifying wilderness with its fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty ground where there was no water, who brought you water out of the flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna that your fathers did not know, that he might humble you and test you, to do you good in the end. Beware, lest you say in your heart, 'My power and the might of my hand have gotten me this wealth.' You shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the power to get wealth, that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your fathers, as it is this day." And I tell you, this is a temptation that is perennial. That as we succeed and as we do things, it is very easy to attribute that because I'm smart, because I did this, because I worked that. That's all fine. But you understand that everything that you have is a gift and a blessing from God, and you give him thanks and praise for all that, and you don't become prideful in your heart and say, "Who needs God? I'm Fat City." I heard that bell. I'm Fat City. I'm rolling. I don't need God. It's only the people who are struggling who need God. I'm rolling. I don't need God. That's a lie. Okay? That's a lie, and you need to remember that. More to say, but time's up. Thank you.